Good morning, everyone. What a beautiful day God has prepared for us once again here at Hayshire. It is great to gather with you all in worship this morning. Our candles will be lit in a moment as a reminder of Christ's presence among us. We remember that Jesus said, "Where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there with you." And today we do gather together here in person, via video and phone, from all corners of our area into one body of Christ. And whenever we come together as the family and friends of Hayshire, we hope that we find this as a time and a place to rest and to encounter God within our midst. A couple of announcements that I have, and then we'll see what other announcements there are out there. Quick reminder, our sixth annual Holiday Bazaar is coming up this Saturday, the 23rd, from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. Anybody else feel like October is just flying by? Yes, it's just zooming. So our bazaar will be this Saturday from 9 until 2, and it's a great time to start your holiday shopping or even to pick up something for yourself. And quick reminder, we need help with baked goods. And the answer to the question that some have asked is no, you do not need to bake them yourselves. But we ask that whether you bake them or whether you bought baked goods, that you package them in like Ziploc baggies of single serving type packages so that we can distribute them easily during our sale. Also, we need a few more volunteers. So if you are available on Saturday and can work, even if it's only for an hour or two, we would love to have you come and help us out. We have a few things that we need help with. So you can either get in touch with Christine Daniels or you can let me know and I'll add your name to the list. We would appreciate it. Baked goods can be dropped off this Thursday from 9 until 1. Or Saturday from 8 o'clock on, so like 8 to 10 is a good time to drop them off. So that's our bazaar info. Also, quick reminder that the 31st, we will be celebrating All Saints Day. Remember, All Saints Day is when we honor those loved ones that have gone before us, the ones that have passed in this last year from November 1st of 2020 until now. So if you have somebody you would like to have mentioned and lifted up during that service, please get their name to Dawn by Tuesday the 26th. That's next Tuesday the 26th, and they will be part of our celebration that day. And remember, the ones that we lift up do not need to be just Hayshire members. They can also be part of our extended family and friends. So we will honor those who you care about. Other announcements, I know Miss Barb has one.
Good morning. Good morning. I contacted the Hayshire Elementary when a group of us used to go over and bag the food for the children to take home over the weekends. Of course, we can't do that anymore, but some of us used to supply the double bags. We used to double bag them and just take them over and donate them. And I contacted them to see if they could use some. They can use some, but they have to be fresh bags. They can't be reused like we got at the grocery store for our groceries, unfortunately. So if anybody has a way of getting, you know, like a pack of them, like Walmart puts on their little bars there to use, if you have any way of getting them and want to donate them to the elementary, just bring them in to the church and somebody will see that they get there, looking at Brenda. So just fresh bags, they can't be reused. Thank you.
So once again, new/fresh plastic bags. If you have the ability to get a hold of them, we will gladly take those and make sure they get over to the elementary school as part of their bag lunch program for the weekends. Other announcements, joys, or concerns to share? Miss Sally.
Well, the garden is done, but we need somebody, a couple people to come out and tear everything out and then put
Okay. Uh-huh. Do you want to say anything more about that for everybody that hasn't heard yet?
I broke my knee last this week.
Yeah. 28. Yeah, Miss Sally just has said that our garden is done providing its beautiful bounty for this year, and it is time to be put to rest for the winter. So we need some help that can come and pull out all of the old plants and get them into an area for composting, etc. And then over the vegetable garden, we need to lay down fresh cardboard and get that kind of settled so that next year we don't have the weeds that come up like they were this year. So we don't have as much hard work to get it ready to go for planting. And also Sally said, you know, unfortunately this year she can't do help with that work because last week while she was out walking her dogs, she had a fall and broke her kneecap. And she will be having surgery on the 28th. So please hold Sally in your prayers, send her some healing mojo so that she can get better quickly. And she's back on her feet. Okay. So she said the flower side of things, they just need to be trimmed back. The sunflowers, they can be pulled, but the regular other plants in our pollinator garden just need to be trimmed back so that they are going to their dormancy for the winter. So we'll work on getting it ready to go. If you want to help and need access, it should be unlocked, but if you need access, just let us know in the office and we'll make sure that that happens. Other announcements, joys, or concerns? Want to give you an update on prayer requests from last week. Last week, we heard that Wanda Waltz's cousin Billy had been in the hospital with COVID. As of Friday, he has passed away. So we need to continue to hold his family in your hearts and prayers. And Wanda also shared that another one of her cousins, Henry, passed away on Saturday or before as well. So their family has had a rough time of it lately. So please continue to hold them in prayer. So friends, as we enter into this time of worship together, remember that no matter who you are, where you've come from in the week past, or where you're headed in the week to come, for the next 30, 40 minutes or so, you are home. So let us prepare our hearts and souls for worship this morning. Thank you.
Good morning. Would those who are able please rise? Join me in the call to worship. Servants of God, lift up your heads, that the Lord of life may behold our eyes. Servants of God, lift up your hands, that the Lord of life may bless our works. Servants of God, lift up your hearts, that the Lord of life may abide within. You may be seated. Oh, no. Please remain standing for the end. Like sheep, we have gone astray, but like a faithful, loving shepherd, God seeks us out and calls us home. Let us confess how we have gone astray in thought, word, and deed. Please join me in a prayer of confession. Lord Jesus Christ, you know our sins. We want you to do whatever we ask of you, but we are unwilling to do what you ask of us. We want to sit beside you in glory, but we fail to stand beside you in your suffering. We want to be first in your great kingdom, but too often we are among the last to serve the least. Forgive us, pour out our mercy upon us, and wash us clean in your saving grace. All this we ask in your holy name. Amen. Hear the promise of the Lord. Those who love me, I will deliver. When you call me, I will answer. I will rescue you from danger and show you my salvation. Believe this good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Thank you. Please join me in the prayer of illumination. O Lord, by the power of your Spirit, lift us up into your presence to hear the promise of your word and know the joy of your salvation. Amen. The Bible reading today will be taken from the book of Hebrews, chapter 5, verses 1 through 10. Every high priest chosen from among mortals is put in charge of things pertaining to God on their behalf, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sin. He is able to deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is subject to weakness. And because of this, he must offer sacrifice for his own sins as well as for those of the other people. And one does not presume to take this honor, but takes it only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of this reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he had suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. Having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek.
So our second reading this morning comes to us from the Gospel of Mark. We've been continuing through Jesus's final teachings as they are headed on the way to Jerusalem. So hear what Mark has to tell us this morning. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it that you want me to do for you?" They said, "Grant us to sit at your right hand and at your left in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" They replied, "We are able." Then Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." When the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom you recognize as the rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to be great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Here ends our readings this morning. Thanks be to God. So we do find ourselves still here in the midst of Jesus's final teachings to the 12. And one of the common themes that we've been hearing over the last several weeks in this teaching is those who wish to be first must be last and servant of all. Even hearing Jesus repeat these words at least three times in his teachings, James and John still ask that Jesus give them the seats immediately at his right and his left. Many find this very odd and disturbing, especially because the request comes immediately on the heels of Jesus's third prediction of his impending death. The request is so out of sync that it seems like they weren't paying attention to what Jesus even said. Even Jesus seems a bit surprised by their request to do whatever they ask of him. He even questions their ability to fulfill the roles those seats bring with them. He says, "Are you able to drink the cup that I drink or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" James and John answer without hesitation, "We are able." The traditional interpretation of this whole story is that James and John don't truly understand what they're asking. Of course, that seems easy to say. Even Jesus says this in his text in verse 38. It's perceived that James and John only seek their own sense of privilege and elevation of status. Scholars often use verse 41 as a means of supporting that point, emphasizing that the other 10 were angry when they heard what James and John were trying to do. Is that all there is to the story? The unknowing selfish request of two of Jesus's disciples to be granted an extra dose of glory and privilege? I mean, how is that supposed to help us? Knowing what we know and believing that James and John really had been paying attention when Jesus made his final predictions of his impending death, not to mention those two previous predictions, why would anyone ask or take the risk of making such a request that would put them in the spotlight with Jesus? Knowing what we know, why would anybody want to do that? Well, even after Jesus tries to give them the chance to rethink what they are asking of him and the chance to change their minds, he says, "Are you sure about this? Is that really what you want?" James and John are still adamant that this is what they want. They're able to follow Jesus no matter what. Wow, that's faithful discipleship at its best, or its craziest. As we have learned, there is usually a deeper meaning or reason to our scriptural stories. Why are James and John so adamant that what they are asking Jesus to grant them? Charles Campbell encourages us to look at the motivation behind the request. He says maybe Jesus's ominous prediction of his passion has become clear to these two. And maybe they understood what lies ahead. And being afraid, they seek the promise of a secure future, one with Jesus still in it. That sounds like a reasonable response to me. Well, Father Michael Marsh tells us that we all have those people in our lives that attract and draw us to them. Their lives speak to us of love and friendship. They show us something about ourselves. Their presence changes who we are. They call us from that best part of who we are. And in them, we catch a glimpse of something holy, something meaningful, something life-giving. We want to get as close as we can to them. We don't want to let the chance slip away. We want to be next to them, not because of who we are, but because of who they are. That is what Christ offers to each one of us. So let's take a moment to think about that relationship between James and John and what they've had with Jesus. In Mark's gospel, they are the second pair of brothers, or they are the third and fourth individuals to be called to follow him, right after Simon Peter and Andrew. I don't know if the order that they were called has anything to do with it or not, but Peter, James, and John become Jesus's closest companions, his confidants, his inner circle. Remember, we see that when Jesus asks them to go with him to Jairus's house to heal the daughter in Mark chapter 6, verses 1 through 6. And then in Mark 9, verses 2 through 8, Jesus invites him to go up on the mountain with him, where they witness Jesus's transfiguration and hear the voice of God call him the beloved. They are told by God to listen to him. So James and John, along with Peter, have had a very different experience with Jesus than the rest of the disciples. They have witnessed the most intimate and divine moments of Jesus's ministry. They have seen things the others did not. They were invited in when the others were not. Marsh reminds us. So they have seen in Jesus something no one else could show them. So how could they not ask to sit next to him in his glory? Marsh believes that James and John are not asking for their own glory. They're asking for Jesus's glory. They're only asking for what they have already caught a glimpse of, and they do not want to lose the life that they have experienced with Christ, Marsh states. That is totally understandable, even more understandable than the belief that the disciples, especially these two, after all that they had witnessed and been part of, still had no clue of who Jesus was and what the future would hold for him and them. I am betting that each of us have had moments when we have experienced a glimpse, a brush of and with divinity. When we have experienced the beauty and presence and holiness of Christ and of God. Those times when our breath catches in our throats, when we feel a sense of euphoria, excuse me. When we feel a sense of euphoria that nothing else can produce, or when we experience a sense of warmth and peace and love, even when things around us are crazy and chaotic and scary. Those are the times when we absolutely get it. And we feel in the moment that everything about our life is different. We have those aha moments. We can relate to how James and John felt and what they asked Jesus to give them. We too don't ever want to lose that feeling, that presence in our lives. But yet over time, as we get caught back up in our daily lives, that feeling fades no matter how much we try to hold on to it. And we are left wondering if we have ever experienced it at all. And like the other disciples, we long for that presence, that experience we had so briefly glimpsed and have been blessed with. And in those moments when our experience seems to have drifted away and we hear others talking about their own, we can deeply miss what we do not have. We can even become jealous or angry like the other disciples in today's story. Marsh confirms that Jesus doesn't allow the 10 to sit by themselves. Remember, he calls them. He calls them back. And he permits no separation between the 10 and James and John, regardless of where they are on their journey, their experiences, questions, or struggles. They're all to walk the same path. They're all to be servants of one another and to all. They are to stand as one body of disciples and walk one path, following one Lord, Marsh says. So today we too walk that same path and are part of that same body of believers, of disciples. The beauty of living in community and sharing ministry together is that when one loses energy, when their hope is flagging, another is there to lift them up, to offer us the support and the encouragement that we need. And it is in the living and the working together that we will find our hope and our challenge, our purpose and our peace. For it is in one another that we find and share the friendship of Jesus. And it is in the acts of doing for others that we catch a glimpse of divinity. Jesus, God, the divine, are hidden in plain sight. If we have eyes to see and ears to hear, Jesus invites us to enter into a relationship that allows the hidden to be revealed and experienced as a regular part of our daily lives. And through these glimpses of the divine, we have the hope and joy of God's promises fulfilled in and for each of us. Thanks be to God. Amen. please bow your hearts and minds in prayer with me this morning. Precious Lord, you came to live among us, taking on human flesh and all its challenges and frailties, so that we might learn to see the divine in all aspects of our everyday lives. Give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts to believe. Today we turn to you and ask that you hear our prayers and offer your healing grace and love as only you can. We pray for the local, national, and global church, that it might exhibit your way to a life of service and faith and love. We pray for the international community, that it might learn the way of compassion, justice, and peace for all. We pray for anyone who's suffering physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. Help us to be their companions through their personal darkness, and may we be conduits of healing from you. We pray for the earth, our beloved home. Help us to be proper stewards of your creation. We remember those who have come to their eternal rest, and we wrap our loving arms of comfort around those who grieve. May they feel your loving presence in and through us. We lift up in silence any prayers we hold in the corners of our hearts, especially those that we have yet to find words to form. For you know and understand all things in us. Loving God, hear our prayers, both spoken and unspoken. We offer to you our whole lives, the good and the bad, the confident and the uncertain, the bold and the timid. May we be willing instruments of your love and peace in our families, our communities, and our world. We pray all of this with humble hearts, remembering and giving thanks in the way that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We offer the gifts of our lives to the Lord.
Holy God, we give you thanks for all your gifts of goodness and grace. Receive these gifts from our hands as a sacrifice of praise to you, and teach us to honor each day by your obedience to your will. Amen.
It is that time again. And it's hard to say that we must need to part once more. I love our times together, and this always brings a little bit of sadness into my heart when we must part. But we know that every time we come together and every time that we leave, we go with the glorious and amazing gift of God's peace. So friends, may the peace of Christ be with each of you. Go in peace, have a blessed week, and I will see you soon. Take care, everybody. Y'all are so good. I'm the one that messed up this week. I totally jumped to the very end rather than doing our commission and blessing, so please join me now. The Son of Man came to serve, not to be served. We will follow Christ's example and give all to our God and one another. May the knowledge and the love of the one who knit the earth together rest with you and give you strength to help others for the glory of God, now and forever. Amen. Now, my friends, go in peace. Have a blessed week. Thank you.